TV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome to Communications 300. My name is Geri Girardin, and we're going to spend the next couple of hours talking about some of the ins and outs of business communication and how we can all improve it. I think most of us can improve it at our business communication, although I will share an interesting tidbit with you to start with, and that was a recent study or research project that was done in the United States. And the question was asked of managers, what is the biggest problem in organizations today? And overwhelmingly, the response was communication is the biggest problem. Okay, fine. So we all acknowledge that's something that needs to be worked on. However, The interesting aspect of this study was that these researchers then came back and asked of those same managers, asked them how they would rate their own communication skills, and these managers rated their communication skills quite high. So you can see there's a little bit of a disconnect between what we see as the problems and what we see as our own skill set. And so this is why I say, based on that research, this is why I say that we all need to, or should, or could improve our communication skills in organizations. Another interesting fact to add on to that is that it's been shown that organizations who are known as effective communicators do better with their stock price in the end. So all interesting things to consider. So I'm happy to have you with us today. I hope that you will settle in and respond to questions that I ask you, students. I would love for you to text your answers in. I get to see them on the screens that are in front of me, and also the general public. We have a phone line, 1-800-339-1193, and I invite your calls and would love to hear from all of you. So this class is part of the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program. It's broadcast live on this cable television channel and webcast on the internet each week. So this spring we'll be broadcasting four classes: Political Science 310, Current Issues in American Government on Tuesdays from 7 until 9, and then Social and Behavioral Science 318, Cultural Pluralism, on Saturdays from noon until 1:40. Political Science 335, International Politics, on Saturdays from 1:50 until 3:30. And then Communication 300, Organizational Communications, this course, on Sundays from noon until 2. So if you'd like more information about the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program, visit our website. It's at the bottom of the screen, appliedstudies.tv, or give a call, 866-278-6789. So a little later on in the program, we're going to watch a clip. Our text for my students that are currently tuned in, our text starts off with a discussion about a fairly recent movie called Up in the Air. And there's an interesting clip in there that I'm going to show you a little bit later, just before we bring our guest in. And we're going to have an opportunity to kind of tease apart what really makes sense in terms of what is the message that we want to communicate to others and how should we communicate that. Now, this was something that really didn't affect people that much. They didn't really have to think about it and make those kinds of decisions earlier on in our business lives of the United States, because we didn't have to deal with social media, we didn't have to deal with computers. It was basically, write a letter by hand, get somebody to jump on their horse and deliver it, right? But now that we're in the modern age and we have all these tools to use, we have to think a little bit more, in a more smart way about exactly what it is that we're, first of all, we're trying to communicate, what is it that we hope to communicate, and really what is the most appropriate way to communicate that message. So these are things that are, I think, really worthwhile thinking about, even though when we hear them, go, oh, well, that's a no-brainer, that's simple, but really to kind of think in terms of our own communication processes, and probably some of you out there are managers, supervisors, leads in your own right, and others, your ordinary working person. Either way, we have to communicate. If we're just a regular old working person, we have to communicate to our supervisors, people that we report to, we have to communicate to our peers, and if we happen to be in some position of management, or maybe not even, what about those people in organizations that are strong influencers? They don't necessarily have official title, blessed by the organization, that now you have permission to tell other people what to do, but somehow, by virtue of their influencing abilities, people listen to them. And so if you happen to be in either of those categories, if you happen to be either just your regular old worker, or if you happen to be in a position of management, or if you happen to be an informal leader, you kind of know when you have the ability to influence people, then we all those three groups really need to pay attention a little bit more to really what is our message and how we're communicating it out to others. So I have a question for you. So how would you rate after that? How would you rate your communication skills? Let's say on a scale of 1 to 10, and students, please text in. On a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being the best and 1 being the worst, and you know, maybe 3, 4 needing some improvement, and 5, 6 doing a half-decent job, 7, 8 pretty effective, more to learn. On a scale of 1 to 10, how would you rate your communication skills? And then tell me why. What is it that people have said to you? What kind of feedback have you received about your communication skills? Or maybe a sense of how effective you are at getting things done. So I'd love to get your responses. So please students, text in. So two questions around communication skills. One is, how would we rate ourselves? But then the other question is, how do other people rate us? And you know, one of the things that I love to do is to invite my students every so often to, you know, learn something today, apply it tomorrow. And I love the idea of offering my students and others, all of you professional students out there that are not getting a degree, but you're just, you know, in front of your televisions watching all of the fabulous programming that Cal State Dominguez Hills offers to you over the television. You might think about two things. You might think about how do I rate my communication skills, and then how do others rate my communication skills? What have others said about that? And so my suggestion to you along those lines is maybe sometime this week at work you could say, you know, we were having this discussion in my communications class, and got me thinking about my communication skills and how effective I was. And so you might ask your boss, you know, ask your boss to rate you on your communication skills and see what they say, see what he or she says. And the good thing about asking those kinds of questions of your manager, your boss, is that what you're doing is you're asking for feedback. And so it's kind of a more comfortable situation than, you know, the performance review where your raise depends on your performance. This is more informal, plus you're asking for it, and usually you can get some pretty good conversation going. And then the question is, oh, you rated me a 6 out of 10. What kinds of things could I do? What do you think, boss? What do you think, manager, I can do to improve my communication skill set? And, you know, lots of rich conversation come out of that. Plus, the other wonderful thing about that is that When we communicate to our managers, when we ask our managers those kinds of questions, what we're doing is communicating to our managers that we have a vested interest in improving, not something that's prescribed by the organization, but something that's self-initiated. And our managers tend to pay attention to that. They tend to get, And I know that's certainly true for me as a university professor. A lot of times students will say, well, I want that A. And of course, that's pretty standard lingo for us professors to hear. On the other hand, when I hear a student asked for feedback on an assignment or something, perhaps the feedback wasn't as much as they wanted or as direct as they wanted, and they asked me for feedback because they really want to improve, that gets my attention. It's like, oh, they're really interested in improving. So you might try that with your boss. Oh, and so Richard's written in. Hi, Richard. Thanks. Richard says, I communicate better and clearer when I take the time to prepare my message. When I'm rushed, I miss things or I make things less clear. Yeah, I think so. I think that's kind of my problem too. But that's a very good point for us to build on, that we really need to take the time to prepare. And think about it. This is why many organizations have public relations departments, because it really takes one person or a team of people to really kind of think through the implications, and I think that's what you were driving at, Richard. Yes, you can say things, but you know, how are people going to take it? How are you delivering the message? How are people going to interpret? And what's, you know, are you going to motivate people to do something different or not? So these are all questions that we need to consider to improve our communication skills. So let's step back a little bit and talk about the communications process. But before we do that, I should probably talk a little bit about myself and let you know my students have my information up on the website, and so you have a sense of who I am, but perhaps others out there not so much. So I've been teaching for Cal State Dominguez Hills for a number of years now and have taught Communications 300 course a number of times now, so I'm pretty comfortable with it. Although I have to say that this year we have a brand new book, but a brand new edition, and it's very wonderful indeed. It's got a rich body of text and so many resources. So I really love that we're upgrading to that text. And so I want to mention that, because I know that it was a few pennies that you had to pay out to get that book. It wasn't cheap, but it's worth the money, I guarantee you. So in addition to teaching at Cal State Dominguez Hills, I've also taught for several other universities too as an adjunct professor, and before that, and working in the consulting field as well. And then before that, I was an internal consultant with a local telecommunications company. And so I have spent probably the last 20 years or so involved in communications, in leadership development, in performance improvement, in helping new managers and even maybe not so new managers kind of grapple with the principles of management and how they can apply them effectively. And then the other aspect is also culture. Is culture in organizations is an important consideration too. And we think about, well, you know, how is it that we communicate? And so you might, students and others, you might take a step back and look at, might ask that question of yourself. How do we communicate in my company? Are we communicating in a very respectful way? Do I see managers rushing out of their offices, screaming about this, that, or the other thing? And so, sort of kind of noticing about what the style of communication is. Oh, Jordan's written in as well. Jordan says, I'm reviewed every 6 months. Oh, every 6 months. Very good. For your job, and communication is one of the review marks. Ah, lovely. I'm happy to hear that. And I usually receive a 6 out of 7. Oh, that's beautiful. 6 out of 7. Okay. And so thanks for that, Jordan. And you'd give yourself a 9 out of 10, which I guess correlates pretty much to the 6 out of 7. And so I wonder, Jordan, what it is that that earns you that 6%? That earns you the 6 out of 7. What is it that your bosses are noticing about what you do? Perhaps you could just add another phrase or another line in there to help us. But thanks for responding. I appreciate that. So communication. Well, guess what? We have a new model of communication recently in the business world. So the old model of communication basically said, you know what, all the attention is on the speaker, and that was the communication model. It sort of was like a one-way. It went from the speaker out to whoever the audience was, but that doesn't fly anymore in our modern culture. That's a model that's well and truly dead and needs to be buried very deeply. Now, what we're more concerned about is two-way communication, right? It starts with an idea in the communicator's mind and ends up with feedback from the receiver. And so there is a model of that in our textbook, and it's just behind me are the components of communication. So let's bring that up full screen and have a quick look at the components of communication when we think about the new model. So we're looking first at the stimulus, and that's just an idea in someone's mind. Maybe the stimulus might be something like a customer service issue, yes, or it could be a natural disaster, or it could be a falling stock price. So all of those kinds of things create stimulus for, oh, we need to do something. So the message is created. And then there are filters, and you know, all of you know, that you tend to put a filter, you tend to put a filter on your messages when you want someone to think well of you. Like, for example, when you're handing in a report for your boss, if there are a couple pieces missing, you want to be able to explain, you know, create kind of context for it. That's what a filter is. And then the message itself. And the message can be positive, it can be negative, it can be strong, it can be weak. So the way that people receive the message is an aspect of the message itself as well, too. And then we need to look at the medium. Mr. McLuhan years ago said the medium is the message. And boy, oh boy, do we ever know that these days. That's for sure. Depending on if you're using Facebook, if you're shouting across the aisle, if you're texting, so many ways these days. The actual tools that we're using are part of the message as well. And then the last component of communication is the destination, actually getting to the source, getting to the important source that it was meant to get to in the first place. Interesting story. When I'm driving up, I live in Orange County, and so when I'm on the freeway driving up to prepare for being with you all, I listened to the radio, and I heard an interesting news story today about there's a newspaper in New York that took it upon themselves to publish the names. Some of you may have heard about this, to publish the names of people who own guns. And it had a big backlash, a big reaction to that. Couple of things about that. One is that the newspaper was within their rights to get that information. It was simply a Freedom of Information Act request, yes. But the actual motivation for publishing it, maybe that was a little suspect. Because when you consider that there are women that may have, and these are names of people who have guns in the home, not permission to carry, not permission to carry a concealed weapon, but to have a firearm in the home. And perhaps, surely, among that list of names that were published, there are women who were who have court orders against abusive husbands, that kind of thing, and now people know where they live. So it was not a judicious thing to do and has raised a hue and cry throughout the land within their rights to do it. So a little later on in the chapter, we're going to talk about ethical communication. So within their rights to do it, but maybe when you consider all sides of the picture, maybe not the most ethical thing to do. So we look at the whole span of communication, not just as a single point event, but as something that has a beginning, a middle point, an end point, and is an ongoing process. And so when we think about objectives, what are the objectives of the communicator? What are the objectives of the audience? Then that needs to be a factor in all of this as well. The other aspect that we're going to look at as we look at one of our learning objectives this hour is to think about legal consequences. Oh, legal consequences. So we have to be very mindful of in this litigious society that we live in, are what some of the legal consequences of the way in which we communicate and the way that we choose to communicate. And so best advice, follow the guidelines that your organization gives you, and any organization that is, you know, a little bit bigger than a mom and pop organization will have some kind of guidelines, how we're going to handle our email and all that kind of stuff. Remember that if you want the world to know something, just put it in an email, because you never know. Once you hit that send button, you never know where that email has gone. We'll explore the legal ramifications of that kind of communication. So let's turn to our learning objectives. Our first learning objective is to look at the components of communication, which is something that we just took a quick look at. And then we want to look at barriers towards effective communication. There are all kinds of barriers. We'll explore that, not just, you know, a truck going by outside, not just, our perception, but many, many barriers that really stop the effective flow of communication. We also want to look at what's our criteria for choosing which communication media we're going to use? And really, this is what the clip from the movie Up in the Air really points to. And our third learning objective is to, how are we going to avoid nasty legal ramifications of anything that we happen to put out there? And then the last point, my favorite topic, is how can we communicate ethically? So Steve's written in. Hi, Steve. Steve says, in some areas I would rate my communication a 9, and in other areas a 4. I think that's very sensible, Steve. I think that we are better in some areas than others. He goes on to say, I'm very good at training and communicating ideas in front of a group. Thanks, Toastmasters. Woohoo, yes. However, email needs work. Yes, very nice, Steve. I appreciate you, appreciate that comment, because we're all busy. Time is money. Yes, chop chop. And a lot of times we may send things out. Sometimes we try to make a joke. We're thinking something. The person that's receiving the email, they don't get the joke at all. It falls flat or is distasteful. Or we have spelling errors or grammatical errors in our emails right away. You know, even we can miss it very easily. And then, of course, with texting, we get our words corrected for us. And if we're rushing, then we get, you know, you've all seen those jokes on Facebook of what text messages can end up looking like. So I agree. I think my email needs work as well, too. And Jordan's responded again. Jordan says, it's usually because I respond to emails in a timely, professional manner. So important, yes. So what is the appropriate business time frame for responding to emails? 24 hours, 36 hours, 72 hours? What guidelines has your organization set out for you? And then, I didn't quite finish on Jordan, but thank you for responding to that, Jordan. I appreciate it. So those are our learning objectives for this hour. So this idea of business communication is important for any job. So why? So Why is business so important? Why is it important regardless of what job you do, whether or not you're a forklift driver, or you're a public relations person, or you're a customer service person, or you work in the warehouse doing fulfillment, or whatever it is that you're doing? Why would you say, students, please text me, why would you say that communications are so important for any old job at all? The other point that I want to make is that when we communicate well, there are substantial rewards. And what kind of rewards would those be? She says that we get rewarded for communicating well. Well, I think one thing that we've certainly learned is that those people that communicate well in organizations get the promotions. It's true. They get the promotions because people feel that they can relate to them. People feel comfortable around them. People feel that they get what is being said by that individual. And then, of course, the other aspect is that there are great risks of communication failures. When we don't take the time, when we rush, when we haven't considered all perspectives, and maybe check in with someone, maybe check in with a trusted other and bounce an idea off them before we make those big announcements, then we reduce our risk for failure. So for students, on page 6 of the text is a handy-dandy little graphic called the internal communication process, opening a store. And I think as we're talking, you might refer to that and work through the process, the communication process, to see some pretty obvious things that need to be considered. It seems like a no-brainer, but once we start thinking about that in terms of our own situation, I'm sorry, I've got a hair stuck on my face somewhere. That's better. Thank you. So I'd like to turn to a discussion of formal and informal communication for my students. It's on page 9, and then there's a PowerPoint that I'd like to bring up full screen for you in terms of formal and informal communication. I think that's going to come up in a minute. And so when we think about formal communication, there are different directions. We're thinking about how are we actually communicating. We're communicating, first of all, if you're a manager, if you're a supervisor, then you need to talk to the people that are your direct reports. That's a very important way of communicating. And the best way to communicate downward to people is to give people as much information as they need to know, and to give people a chance to check in and clarify anything that you've said. Upward communication, on the other hand, is when we're talking to our managers. And very important point here, when we're talking to our managers, just the facts, ma'am, just the facts. So when we're talking to our direct reports, we need to influence. We need to tell them the reason why we're doing something. However, when we're communicating upward, just the facts, ma'am, just the facts. No need to convince. Sometimes our managers can get a little suspicious of us if we're spending a lot of time trying to justify our actions, trying to convince them of something. So better with our managers, just the facts. And then this idea of lateral communication, and what we're really talking about here but we're really talking about communicating to our peers. Oh, it's right there, our peers. So influencing people that we're working on projects with, influencing the person that sits at the desk next to us. You know, maybe they're, I don't know, maybe they have a sloppy desk and you'd like them to clean it up a little bit. All of those areas are important. And then we have informal communication. And the informal communication is really the grapevine, isn't it? So question for you. Do you rely on the grapevine? Those of you that are managers, is the grapevine something that's important to you? Do you like to use it? Do you think it has validity? Do you disregard it? Give me a call. Let me know. 1-800-339-1133. 1193. I'd be curious to hear what you think about the grapevine. And students, what about the grapevine for you in your organization? Is it alive and well and kicking? Do you participate in it? I know I do. When I'm in an organization and the information is not quite as robust as I need it to be, when whatever information I have doesn't quite satiate my need for understanding that particular situation, then I will go underground to the grapevine and see what it is that people are saying. So I think that a smart manager will utilize the grapevine and take advantage of understanding what it is that people are saying. So one, so that they can correct it if there are problems, if there are problems with misinformation, but two, also to kind of get a bead on what it is that people are saying. So as we think about barriers to communication, I'd like to introduce that topic by a short video clip. It's about 2.5 minutes long. It's from Office Space. Remember that little conversation that they were having, Jennifer Aniston was having about flair. Let's watch it. Miscommunications.
Joanna, could you come here a minute, please?
Yeah. I'm sorry, I was late. I was having lunch, and I,
We need to talk about your flair.
Really? I have 15 pieces on.
Well, okay, 15 is the minimum, okay?
Okay.
Now, you know, it's up to you whether or not you want to just do the bare minimum or, well, like Brian, for example, has 37 pieces of flair. Okay. Mm. A terrific smile.
Okay. So you want me to wear more?
Look, Joanna.
Yeah.
People can get a cheeseburger anywhere. Okay. They come to Tchotchkes for the atmosphere and the attitude. Okay. That's what the flair is about. It's about fun.
Yeah. Okay. So more than, yeah.
Look, we want you to express yourself, okay? Now, if you feel that the bare minimum is enough, then okay. But some people choose to wear more, and we encourage that, okay? You do want to express yourself, don't you?
Yeah.
Okay, great. That's all I have.
Okay.
Joanna.
Yeah.
We need to talk. Do you know what this is about?
My flair?
Yeah. Or your lack of flair, because I'm counting and I only see 15 pieces. Let me ask you a question, Joanna. Mm. What do you think of a person who only does the bare minimum?
Huh, what do I think? You know what, Stan? If you want me to wear 37 pieces of flair like your pretty boy over there, Brian, why don't you just make the minimum 37 pieces of flair?
Well, I thought I remembered you saying that you wanted to express yourself.
Yeah, you know what? Yeah, I do. I do want to express myself. Okay? Then I don't need 37 pieces of flair to do it. All right? There's my flair. Okay? And this is me expressing myself. Okay? There it is. I hate this job. I hate this goddamn job, and I don't need it.
So have you ever found yourself at cross purposes like that? And you could see how the conversation was going. What he was, even though they were talking about flair, even though verbally the words coming out of their mouths were about flair, it was really, the conversation was really about something else. Really, it was about employee engagement, it was about going the extra mile, it was about team participation, it was just a whole lot of other things that were embodied in this conversation about flair. And you know, I'm kind of a high structure girl. I like it when my bosses tell me very specifically what it is that I have to do. it makes it easier for me because then I understand what the expectations is, and expectations are. And I'm going to guess that a lot of you are similar to me in that you like things fairly well defined, as did Jennifer Aniston's character in the movie Office Space. She simply wanted a definition. She had her minimum number on. She was being criticized for the minimum number. Raise the minimum number, or obviously she was not crazy about wearing flair. Other people didn't mind it so much. So these are the kinds of cross conversations that we have, which tend to drive employees crazy if you happen to be a manager. And the flip side of that probably drives managers crazy as well, too. So that's my introduction to verbal and nonverbal barriers. And so let's talk about some of those. So some of the verbal barriers can certainly be inadequate knowledge. When you don't know, you don't know. And sometimes you don't know that you don't know, right? So just not having adequate information or not even just information, but vocabulary. I notice for myself that especially when I'm in a store, perhaps. Oh, I know what it was. So I was in Fry's the other day, and I was looking for a cord to connect my iPhone to a speaker. And so I had no idea what to call that cord. And so I felt like an idiot. I was stumbling around for words and sort of gesturing with my hands, trying to make my request known. So this is what happens, isn't it, in organizations when we're not educated, when we don't know that it's speaker cord, then we're sort of bumbling around and not being very clear and wasting other people's time. So inadequate knowledge, inadequate vocabulary is certainly one. And then interpretation, the way that I interpret a set of instructions, the way that you interpret what I've just said, that plays a lot, that has a big role in communication as well, too. And then language. People have different ideas about what words mean depending on what part of the world that they came from. Yes, and a couple of good examples about that in our text. It amused me. There was a sign for my students on page 11 saying public toilet tourism. Not exactly the correct interpretation toilets, public toilets over here for tourists' use. Didn't quite come out that way. So language can be a problem. And then inappropriate use of expressions is certainly, using slang or using jargon that people don't understand, people are not familiar with. I don't know about you, but when I find that when people around me are using jargon that I don't get, it puts me on the outside. I don't feel like I'm on the inside anymore. I feel like, I don't know what that means. I need someone to help me out. And then I don't feel included in a group. So that's something to watch out for as well, too. Then when it comes to nonverbal barriers, sending conflicting signals, doing one thing, stating another thing, so what your mouth's saying and what you're actually doing. You know that old adage, do what I do, do what I say, not what I do, right? That's how it goes, do what I say, not what I do. And that's something that can confuse direct reports when their manager does one thing, when a manager wants employees to be in at 8 o'clock, to punch in by 8 o'clock, but they come in at, say, 9:30. Now, what we don't understand as employees is that the manager is working way later than us, but those sort of things need to be defined. They need to be talked about so people know exactly what's what. A couple of correspondence from students. Richard says, Grapevine is definitely alive and well. Good to hear it. Many times you get more information, you have to double check for accuracy though. Yeah, it's as simple as that. It's good information, just, grain of salt. Very good, Richard, thanks for that. And then Brittany, hi Brittany, thanks for writing in. Brittany says, I try to stay in contact with the Grapevine because everyone's opinions matter. Yeah, hello, very good point. It's good to know what the people on your team are thinking and feeling so you can be a better leader to them. Perfect. Couldn't have said it better than myself. Thanks, Brittany. So moving on to nonverbal barriers, sending those conflicting signals, also inappropriate emotion. Sometimes people are like way over the top with their emotion. Sometimes they're like way too low, being kind of deadpan, not expressing anything at all. That can throw people off. It can confuse people. And then there are distractions, nonverbal barriers, or people talking outside the group in a loud way, loud noises, music, all kinds of interference of that nature. And then the last nonverbal barrier is perception, the way that we see ourselves. The way, a good example of that to illustrate is that at one point in my career, I was working for a manager that wasn't the best manager for me. I'm sure that she was a wonderful manager and has gone on to be successful, but it didn't work so well for me. And I swear that during that period where I was working under that manager, I was so stupid, literally. I was so, my anxiety, my stress level was so high that I just didn't have a brain in my head anymore. I couldn't even add two and two. That's one of the things that happens when we have those communication barriers that we're just not able to get past. So let's move on to our learning objective two, which was to recap our learning objective two, those barriers. And so when we think about barriers to communication, are they are those damaging to communication? Do they create problems for you? Are there any examples, students, that you can offer about how some of those barriers have created problems for you, yourself, others? And it looks like we have a phone call, so welcome, caller.
Hi, my name's Albert.
Hi.
Well, I saw
this?
Your clip there on the communication.
Albert,
player,
hi.
And Hi there. Now, I was saying what I found interesting was I think there was kind of the disconnect between the manager and the manager and his boss there, because he didn't seem to have a standard how many made it real clear the buttons he's referring to. He was talking about flair, and you'd go like, what's flair? If I was a customer, I'd be like, what's this guy talking about, and so he didn't make it really clear to his subordinate that you're supposed to have a certain amount of those buttons or tags on your uniform, because I think that's probably part of the marketing thing of their restaurant.
You wouldn't think it would be that hard, Albert, would you? But really, go ahead.
Well, logically, you don't think it would be that hard, but then he probably is not really clear on how to run the business,
and that's a good point. Do you have an example that you can share from your experience, Albert? Is there anything more you want to say about that?
Well, one example I think is that you usually have an orientation for your employees.
Yes.
Where you tell your employees that this is the cost, this is the uniform, this is your expected level of performance.
Yeah.
And and if you're required to have 30 or more of those buttons on you, then you're supposed to have those buttons on.
That's the expectation. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Good
and
point.
The girl should have been informed of that.
Absolutely.
And that was that should have been his duty to do that.
And you raise a good point.
It's
respectful communication, don't you think? It's his duty.
Right.
Thanks, Albert. Thanks for that call. I appreciate that.
Also, enough too was another point too.
Go ahead.
Him arguing in front of his customers is not good policy. That's not good for business.
say that again, Albert. I missed it.
No, I think him arguing in front of he was arguing near around his customers. There were his customers could hear.
Oh yeah. Oh
good,
yeah.
That's
yeah.
not good business policy.
Yeah, so
that gives a bad image to the business.
Good point about that. That was what we would put in the category of disrespectful communication, right? I mean, think of how embarrassing.
If you and I were a customer sitting there at a table and hearing him fight with his people and
not
stuff
nice.
Like this, treating his people really bad, then we shouldn't be coming here anymore.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, That's right. Good points, Albert. Right. Thank you very much for that. Oh, great. Someone who called. Thanks, Albert, for calling in. That's great. Love to hear from you. So there are some words in organizations that can be problematic, and I believe we have a slide with some commonly used words. Do we have that PowerPoint? That PowerPoint slide? No. Yes, sir. No, we don't have that. Okay, that's fine. Okay, there we are. So here are some. What do you think? Do you know some of these terms? Do you know some of them? I don't know. Do you know SEO, search engine optimization? Is that a term you're familiar with? So that's jargon, wouldn't you say? And how about JPEG? Now, I'll bet we all are familiar with the sound of that word, but do we actually know what the word means? Joint Photographic Experts Group? And then retweet, well, we've heard that. Do we really know what it is? Or maybe more importantly, do we know how to do it? Do we know how to retweet? And then VOIP, Voice Over Internet Protocol, for accepting internet phone calls, making and accepting internet phone calls at Skype, right? And how about this term, patch, a quick fix for a programming defect. So, you know, these terms are out there, and if we don't know what they are, then we're kind of left in the dark. The only reason why I know what patch means is because I like to listen to Leo Laporte, who's the tech guy, driving back, actually, from my Sunday afternoons with you, and what wonderful man that helps educate me about everything technological. And so he's always talking about patches. Otherwise, I would have no idea what a patch is. So those are just some examples. How about OS? Do you know what OS means? Probably most of us do. Yes, operating system. How about FAQ? Do you know what that means? I had to scratch my head many years ago. Nobody told me. I had this sheet of paper that said FAQ on it, and I had to figure it out. Oh, frequently asked questions. I see. Now we're a little bit more conversant with that term. Yeah. Or how about POS? POS, point of sale. Do you know that one? POS, point of sale. Or AI, artificial intelligence. These are some good ones. How about followers? You know, we usually think about followers in terms of leadership. Followers are people who subscribe to receive other people's tweets on Twitter. Yeah, and thumbnail. Thumbnail. Are you familiar with that term? Thumbnail. So a reduced size of pictures. So there are just some words for us to think about. But how complex our society is, and how we have to be careful when we're using those terms to make sure people understand them and not feel that they're being excluded, or to brush up ourselves and learn some of those terms. Want to show you another video clip. This one is about almost 3 minutes long. And it's just kind of looks like a homemade video clip. A young girl and her boyfriend go into this dress store, and there's a clerk there who is helping them out. And so a couple of questions, students as you and others, as you watch the clip, and perhaps you can text me or call in. So what verbal and nonverbal communications do you see in this clip? What kind of barriers do you see? And do you think the salesperson is too aggressive, or is she being a good salesperson? Let's watch. Let's see.
Oh my gosh, can we stop in here for a minute?
Do we have to?
Yes, I wanna go look at some of the dresses in there. They always have really great stuff.
Oh god, again? You always hate that place.
Well, I mean, the staff are annoying, yes, but, like, it's really cute. Come on.
Oh, fine. Just not for, like, 5 minutes. All right, 5 minutes. That's all I'm giving you.
Why are you filming?
I don't know. You said this place was crazy. I figured I'd get this on film, you know? Document the...
I hate film majors.
All right, I'm sorry.
Hey, let's go.
Hi.
Can I have Did you find anything today?
Oh, no, thanks. I'm just going to look around. Thanks.
Well, just so you know, we have a sale going on.
Oh,
it's 25% off shoes if you buy a pair of jeans.
Oh,
and
okay.
We've got a whole room back here that's also on sale.
All right. That's wonderful.
Yeah. Thank you. Oh, those are great, just so you know. They're really comfortable.
Oh, I have a pair.
Oh, okay, cool. I'm glad. That's very nice. We have way more sizes in the back, too. I think that's the only one up here, but we do have all the other sizes in the back if you need me to get anything for
yeah,
you.
Yeah, thanks.
No, I'm just looking.
Okay.
It's fine, thanks. But if you need different sizes, different colors, just let me know.
That's yeah.
What you can do.
Okay.
God, we really feed these people here.
Yeah, I know.
It's ridiculous.
This is way in the back, but this would look absolutely amazing, and it's sort of in two pieces. It's got like an open back thing going on, but it's so wonderful for the summer, and the fabric is so light.
Okay, actually, I wanted to look at that up, see on the ceiling there,
could you get that for me?
I know, like, yeah, the green one. I don't want to be a jerk, but could you...
Yeah,
we
have a tool in the back.
That would be great. Yeah.
I'll go get that.
Big leather thing.
Thanks so much.
Great call. Let's get out of here. Go.
Oh my God.
Well, I told you so.
Shut up.
I knew that was going to happen.
Shut up. I'm not going back there.
Yeah.
All right.
You and me both. Don't worry.
Point taken.
Don't worry. Okay. You don't have to convince me.
Put away that camera, please.
All right.
So what do you think? Effective salespersonship, or was the salesperson too overbearing? I don't know. Personally, I thought she was a little bit too overbearing, or maybe not just a little, maybe a lot. I'm not really happy when people come to my door and try to sell me things. I'm not really happy when I go into a shop and people are offering me one item after another. I feel that I'm quite capable of looking around and making those determinations myself. So I wouldn't have been happy with that style, as obviously the people in the video weren't. But what are some of the communication barriers? Well, certainly perception, I think, was a big one. From the salesperson point of view, perception is, customer, sale, dollars, money, commission, like that, as opposed to being helpful. I think that her retorts were beyond helpful. They were over the top. So just an example of how our communication can put other people off and actually cause us to lose business. Let's move on to learning objective 3, which is to, so what criteria are we going to choose when it comes to our communication media? What methodology are we actually going to use? And so I'd like to bring up a PowerPoint that talks about oral and written channels. And so two ways that we can look at communication. We can look at it in a traditional way. We look at it technology-based. There are oral channels. There are written channels. Let's go ahead and bring this up full screen, and we'll take a look at each of these. So some examples of written communication are, a brochure. You want to go for a holiday somewhere, go for a brochure, go down to AAA. They've got all those. Did you know? Do you know you go down to AAA? If you're a member, you can get all those brochures for free. Another example is financial statements, solicitation letters. I get too many of those. I get letters in the mail telling me that I can opt for cremation rather than burial. I don't want those letters. another example, reports, of course. And then out in the media, magazines, journals, newspapers, that's all of that goes under the heading of communication examples. On the other hand, when we talk about oral communication, what we're really talking about is face-to-face meetings, right? Team meetings, conferences, those kinds of things. Those are the traditional channels of communication. We're either going to get a report, we're going to talk to each other face to face. But now it's a brave new world, isn't it? And there are non-traditional methods of communication. We've got social media, right, abounds, some LinkedIn, Facebook, Twitter. I don't know how many of you are on these social media sites, but if you're not on at least one or more of them, let's go ahead and bring this PowerPoint up full screen. If you're not on at least one of these sites, then you're probably missing out. If we can go full screen to that so everyone can see what this is. So Facebook, now you can even sign into accounts through Facebook, yes? So Facebook has become more than just friends sharing stories. It's actually starting to become more and more of a business tool. Wiki spaces, if you're interested in creating wikis for yourself, is an opportunity to get the word out there. Of course, the thing about wikis is that you need an audience, right? Just because you write it doesn't mean that they'll come. Multimedia, YouTube, which we all love, right? We can get lost in YouTube, Flickr as well. Microblogs, Twitter is certainly considered one of them. And then blog magazines, which are becoming very popular. People are using that. WordPress, very popular, yes? Do any of you use WordPress out there? Just a way to help your customers learn a little bit more about the product. And I certainly rely on that. I go to my Facebook page, and there's an interesting post from someone who I'm basically a Whole Foods vegetarian person, and so anytime there's some interesting commentary about farming or Monsanto or pesticides or recipes or any of that kind of stuff, I'm right there. And so when I click on the link, often I'll come to a WordPress blog where the person that originally posted has a little bit more in-depth information. So I like that because I can go a second layer and learn a little bit more for myself about my topic of interest. But the flip side is the issue that we've heard quite a lot of. Can Facebook get you fired? I'd like to show you a short video clip, about almost 2 minutes long, called Can Facebook Get You Fired? So the flip side of social media, let's watch.
A new court case is putting spotlight on the blurring lines between your professional life and your personal life when it comes to the wild world of social media. The case involves a woman who was fired from her job because she posted negative comments about her supervisors on Facebook. And according to reports, this employee got into a major argument with her boss at work, then decided to vent all of her frustrations on her Facebook wall. But when the bosses found out, she got the boot because her company has a policy against employees making negative comments about their jobs on social networking sites. Now, this case is still working through a lot of technicalities, but it does bring up a pretty good point. Do you have the right to say whatever you want on social networking sites? Can you talk a little smack about your boss or a coworker after a hard day's work? You know, Facebook and other social media platforms, they were originally designed for individuals to communicate with one another. No restrictions or regulations, just hop online and tell the world whatever you want. But since everybody now has a cyber footprint, it's easy to forget that when you comment on something, anybody can see it. It is no longer private. What if I had a bad day at my job and my boss really pissed me off? Could I just come up with a nasty little comment? Could I say, have I mentioned that my boss is an arrogant bastard and doesn't give a rat's ass about his employees? If I made a comment like that, would I be violating my company's policies or just looking for a way to vent? Either way, consider this a reminder to you that everything you do online can come back to haunt you in the real world. So use some common sense, people. If you really value your job, don't go online and criticize your superiors. Otherwise, your next wall post will read, anybody know someone who's hiring?
Good advice. Use some common sense.
A new court case is putting spotlight.
So while we're talking about Facebook, I invite you to go to take a look at your Facebook page and see if there's anything on there that might be questionable, that people that perhaps you're coworkers or perhaps your boss might take offense to. And then the question becomes, do they have a right to feel that way? Isn't your Facebook page your Facebook page? So often I get posts from people who say, you know, if you don't like what I'm saying on my Facebook page, you know, unfriend yourself from me. I don't know, it's a brave new world and we have to navigate our way through it. So then the issue becomes, for business purposes, how are we going to choose the right medium for the right message? The next video clip that I want to show you is a video clip from the movie, a little bit longer, it's about 6 minutes long. It's a clip from the movie Up in the Air. And the character, Natalie, is a bright young thing from just out of college. And George, this is the movie with George Clooney, where George Clooney plays one of her coworkers. And she's announcing the company is downsizing and they're going to be laying off workers. And she's announcing her brave, bold new plan about how she's going to let certain workers go. She can let them know about how they've been terminated via video conferencing. And so the question that we have is this an ethical way? Does it make people feel good? Is it the right way to treat people when you let them go? To not do it face-to-face in person, to do it via video conference? And so these raise all kinds of questions about really how should we conduct business? So it starts to dip into that ethical aspect that we'll talk about after we bring our guest in. But let's watch the video now and just see what you think about Natalie's suggestions. Let's watch.
Hey. I'm thrilled that everyone's back under one roof. Welcome home, boys. I know there's been a lot of whispering about why we're here, so let me jump right in. Retailers are down 20%. Auto industry is in the dump. Housing market doesn't have a heartbeat. It is one of the worst times on record for America. This is our moment. Now, last summer, we received a dynamite young woman here from Cornell, and she had some pretty big ideas that she challenged me with, and my first reaction was, who does this kid think that she is? But after I gave it a listen, she really knocked me out. So with a peek into our future,
very
Natalie
well.
Keener.
If there's one word I want to leave you with today, it's this.
Global.
Global. Our global must become local. This company keeps 23 people on the road at least 250 days a year. It's expensive and it's inefficient. When I came to Craig 3 months ago with this, he told me, and quite astutely, it's only a problem if you have a solution. Well, today I stand before you with just that. You all know Ned in reception. Today I'm gonna fire Ned. Sorry, Ned. I'm sure HR will hire you back this afternoon.
We'll see about that.
Now, Ned could be any employee in any one of our clients' locations worldwide. Strategy packets would be shipped in advance. Ned would be given a seat and find one of our transition specialists waiting for him. Mr. Laskin, the reason we're having this conversation is your position is no longer available.
I don't understand. I'm fired?
Hearing the words you've been let go is never easy. Change is always scary. But consider the following. Anybody who ever built an empire or changed the world sat where you are now. And it's because they sat there that they were able to do it.
My fucking life. Well, what happens now?
This is the first step of a process that will end with you in a new job that fulfills you.
Yeah, but how does it work?
I want you to take the packet in front of you. Review it. All the answers you're looking for are inside. Start filling out the necessary information, and before you know it, you'll be on your way to new opportunities. Now, Ned, I need you to go back to your desk and start putting together your things. As a favor to me, I'd appreciate it if you didn't spread the news just yet. Panic doesn't help anyone.
I understand.
Give it up for Ned. You can start the morning in Boston, stop in Dallas over lunch, and finish the day in San Francisco. All for the price of a T1 line. Our inflated travel budget is eviscerated by 85%. And more importantly, to you guys on the road, no more Christmases in a hotel in Tulsa, no more hours lost to weather delays. You get to come home.
Tell me you're not taking this seriously.
That's why we brought the entire company in from the road, because we're not taking this seriously.
There is a methodology to what I do. There's a reason why it works.
Coke and IBM have been doing this for years, all right? You familiar with them? And just like anything else, you know, it's going to take a few months of sort of transition, and then everybody's going to settle in.
Who are you taking off the road?
How are you not getting this? You're grounded. Everybody's grounded. It's done.
What we do here is brutal, and it does leave people devastated, but there is a dignity to the way I do it.
Like stabbing them in the chest instead of the back. Is that right?
You wanted to see me?
Well, yeah, you know what? Yeah, come on in. Come on in here. Great job.
Thank you. How's everyone taking it?
Great. Listen, I admire your zeal, and I think you have some very good ideas, but you know nothing about the realities of my industry. You can set up an iChat, but you don't know how people think.
Actually, I minored in psychology.
Nice. Okay, kiddo, fire me.
Ryan.
Oh, listen, she's going to be doing this on a regular basis. Don't you want to know if she can fire somebody?
She's fired Ned.
My dog can fire Ned. Fire me.
You don't need to do this.
No, it's okay. I got this. Mr. Bingham, I regret to inform you that your position at this company is no longer available.
Hmm. Who the hell are you?
My name is Miss Keener. I'm here today to discuss your future.
My future? The only one who could fire me is Craig Gregory.
Mr. Gregory hired me to handle this for him.
Handle what? Handle me? Mr. Gregory hired me. He's the only one who could fire me. You know what? I'm going to go talk to him.
Mr. Bingham.
No. You can't follow me. You're on a computer screen, remember?
Ryan.
All right, let's try this again. Fire me again.
I just did.
Actually, you didn't. Fire me.
That's enough. I think we get it.
Mr. Bingham, yeah? I'm here today to inform you that your position is no longer available.
I'm fired?
Yes, you're fired.
Never say fired.
You've been let go.
Why?
This is a mythical situation. How could I possibly know why?
Why doesn't matter. You never know why.
It's important not to focus on the why and rather to spend your energy thinking about your future.
Well, I'm going to spend my energy on suing you unless you give me a good reason why you're firing me.
Mr. Bingham, the reason's not important.
So you're firing me without grounds. Now I really have a lawsuit.
I get what you're trying to say, Ryan.
Don't take this personally, Mr. Bingham.
Personally? This is the most personal situation that you are ever going to enter. So before you try to revolutionize my business, I'd like to know that you actually know my business.
So, what do you think? It looks like she probably jumped the gun a little bit with her assumption about the way that process should go. And what I liked about that clip is that George Clooney's character really kind of helps her, you know, get on a cerebral level that she wasn't doing the right thing. So there are other issues involved there. There's not just what's the most efficient way to do it, but also what are the legal ramifications, and as George Clooney's character also mentioned, what about dignity? What about people's dignity? So there's that ethical consideration as well, too. So I hope you enjoyed that. So I've brought our guest into the studio. So I'd like to welcome Al Batinga. He's been in the training industry for 30 years and started training in the military. He said that's when he caught the training bug. He's a former president of New Horizons, which many of you, I think, have heard about. Right? I certainly have. New Horizons Computer Learning Center. 300 locations worldwide, really? Wow, I didn't realize that. Big organization. He's worked for organizations such as Ingram Micro, Fidelity National, City of Los Angeles, Kawasaki, and Hyundai. And currently, he's consulting for a healthcare organization and travels regularly to Washington. So, woo, lucky you. I love Washington. So welcome, Al.
Thank you.
Nice to have you on the
pleasure.
Show. So before I launch into my series of questions that I wanted to ask you, so what's Washington like this time of the year?
Oh, I was just there a few weeks ago,
yeah,
and it was pretty warm comparatively. I left here expecting all the coldness, but it wasn't there.
It's still warm.
It's still warm. Very nice.
You know, I remember being in Washington. We used to go there quite a bit. Our company used to have conferences there and whatnot. And I remember I was there in the spring, and they got a late storm, and the cherry blossoms were blossoming. And I just happened to be at the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier when it was just such a poignant scene for me. There was the soldier solemnly walking back and forth, Tomb of the Unknown Soldier, all these cherry blossoms in the background, and then these big snowflakes coming.
Wow.
It was just that, you know, it just like grabbed my heart.
Oops, right.
Probably thumped the mic. So. But it just really, really was just a city that I'm so interested in.
Right.
Such an interesting city.
Every three or four times I do what you're doing and I go visit the sites or visit the Smithsonian. I mean, it's a treat.
Been to Library of Congress?
Yes.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
What a place.
Wow, what a place.
What a place. Lucky you. I'm jealous. Can you pack me in your suitcase one of these times? So, you know, I think onto the topic, yeah. So I think that, you know, one of the big mistakes that managers make, maybe not thinking through communications quite enough, not thinking about communication channels, like this person in the video clip, you know, great idea, sure, let's be efficient, but really not bringing all the wisdom, I think, that could be brought to that situation. So when you think about that video clip, Al, and you think about some of the challenges that managers might have in really choosing careful communication channels, I wonder, is that something you come across in your
Absolutely.
Line of work?
All the time. And one of the things about this clip that was very good was they were actually doing some training, and before they got out there, which is the perfect thing to do. So one of the foundational issues that most companies have is they really don't have a training program discussing how we're going to communicate certain things. Is it email? Is it voicemail? Is it face-to-face? When do we do that? So that's probably level one. Everybody needs to do training from a managerial perspective so that we're all on the same page and we handle it in the same way. Secondarily, what happens is we have to communicate certain things in certain ways. So let's say we don't get the training that we need or is necessary. Then we always have to think about what's the best way to communicate this. And for some issues, it's not a meeting. It's not a face-to-face because you're drawing everybody from the office to a meeting place. And it's something that could have been communicated via email.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's those kinds of things. Now, if you want to dig deeper in this and you get down to the next level, then it's dealing with personalities. You know, if you look at four general personality types that you might cover in class or in one of your communication classes, they're amiable, analytical, expressive, and driver. So if you communicate to a driver with additional information that they don't need or want, you're miscommunicating, you're not gelling, you're not communicating at the level they need.
Mm-hmm.
If you go and speak to an analytical and you give them just the facts, the same concept applies, where they're sitting there saying, I want more, I want more, I want more, and you're giving them the 10,000 foot view. So it's very complicated in so many ways, but it's something that if it's practiced, if it's trained, if you come to classes like these and you learn about these kinds of things, you can go into the marketplace and really compete. Because one of the things I heard your background, I've done a lot of managerial training myself, and one of the reasons they fail, at least in my opinion, is they don't do enough training.
Mm-hmm.
So classes like this help because they're out on their own. And I've been in environments where, let's meet once a week. Remember how I hired you? Remember what I did with our meetings? That's what you're gonna do. Let's meet once a week. And really, you're not coached, you're not mentored. And so the likelihood of failure is high.
Mm-hmm,
so,
mm-hmm.
Yes, so the answer to the question is, there's a lot of issues there with the communication style and all kinds of things there, and that's why it's such an important topic.
Oh, that's a beautiful answer. I loved hearing you share all of that because but the other thing I'm thinking about is I want to ask you to build on to that is, you know, you say, well, there's not enough training going on, but of course the other aspect is that time is pushing in on everyone. Time is money. And where's the balance between getting it all done and taking time to really think it through and to do training?
That is probably the biggest issue people have when they talk about training. Because when I go to organizations, people say, we don't have time to train. And they just go through all the issues and challenges from a training perspective. I certainly understand that. When I drove in today, right outside this area, was the firefighters, and they were practicing in the parking lot.
Yeah, I saw that too, yeah.
You know, so if you think about things like the military, athletes, musicians, they all have a training plan. They all do training. And then you get into the professional services, they all do training. And what happens is when they get to a different environment, all of a sudden training falls off the map. And it's simply because they're too busy. Well, you would never say to a police officer, we're too busy to train. That'd be silly. You'd never say to the military, we're too busy to train. That's silly. Now, I'm espousing that in the business community, like most of us are, that's the exact same thing. Now, maybe we don't need 20 hours a month, but maybe we need an hour a week, or maybe we need 4 hours a month, or 8 hours a quarter, or some sort of concept where everybody's training. And one of the best ways to train is to do it right up front. And I'll tell you an example. When I was running New Horizons, we had 12 people, and we moved up and we grew, and now we had 50 and 60 and 100. And we would put people on the phone on day one. So it was, here's the phone book. And I didn't like that because my background is in the military. So I put in a 2-week training program before they even touched the phone. And it changed all our results. And so all of a sudden we were getting the kind of success, because here's what was happening. When people were picking up the phone and practicing, or actually making the call, they were practicing on their customer, which they could never go back to. So you either train in this kind of setting where you're making mistakes and you're going through all of that, or you do it with a customer. So sometimes we have to choose those kinds of issues. And for me, hands down, it's we've gotta take the time. And so that's a big issue, is the thing called time, but we've gotta figure out a time. And obviously we've gotta figure out concise. And I like the multimedia type of environment you have here, where you can do a lot of different things with the training concept.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Oh, such a great answer. And to my question, to my students, I have a please feel free to send any questions in to Al that you may have, and he'll be happy to respond to them as well. So. So Al, what do you think about the legal consequences of communication? What have you, tell us some juicy stories. What have you noticed around that?
Well, we could probably talk about that for hours. Well, I'll give you an example. I took over a company, small division in a larger company. Mm-hmm. And I started talking with the managers, and one particular manager pulled me off to the side and said, and started telling me all the issues that the last VP, how they had treated him, and just went on and on and on. And I actually sat there and said, oh, wow, that doesn't sound good. That's too bad. And I didn't agree with him. I was agreeing on the conversation. In other words, I was listening in on the conversation. Well, it took me about 9 months, and we had to make a decision that we were gonna shut this division down because there was no resources, and on and on and on. Well, within a few days, I got a subpoena. And I had to go to an arbitration. Thankfully, it wasn't court, but I had to go to an arbitration where that conversation where I had agreed with this person, in other words, I was nodding my head, I was smiling, I was saying, wow, that doesn't sound right, was now held on me as agreeing with his plight.
Oh.
And it was a terrible arbitration because I had one of the people who was involved in the OJ trial was as a commentator, was the attorney who was grilling me, and it was not pretty. And in hindsight, I should have said, you know, let's go to HR, human resources, and let's you have a conversation with them. Or let's put it down on paper, and you can send that to human resources. And in hindsight, again, I can see, I know why I did it. I wanted to gain rapport with this person, but it backfired on me, and I had to waste so many hours and actually days on this deposition and other things like that. And there's other things, you know, if you think about sexual harassment. Sexual harassment, really, you don't even have to harass somebody. You could be that person, you could be harassing somebody else, and that person hears about it, and this person be perfectly fine with it. They don't consider it harassment, they consider it a joke. But this person takes offense. So there's many case studies on these kinds of things.
Sure, perhaps a poster on the wall of your office that someone takes offense to, that sexual harassment. So many ways that we have to be aware of communicating. Gosh, that's an interesting story that you shared I could see the process working. I could see that fellow wanting somebody somewhere to admit fault, right? It sounds like. And he said, there's Al, he's the new guy. Let's bend his ear and get him to admit fault. So how did it turn out?
Well, they settled, and it was non-disclosed, so they settled behind the scenes. and it was unfortunate because the other person, the other VP, was still in the company, so it was an elongated concept, but they settled it out of court.
Sounds like a big mess.
Yes, it was a big mess, and it taught me a whole lot.
Well, and then just so I can, just to help our students understand more about, you know, communication in the workplace and how all these things play out. So, Al, so you were a new person, you were trying to, you know, be empathetic, not necessarily agreeing, but listening, right? It ended up in a court case. So how did the organization coach you after the fact about that? Did they at all, or... Tell us about that.
Well, I actually had left the organization, and I was in a totally different organization. And so we didn't have a debrief, but I talked to some of the officers in the company. And obviously, their whole concept was, we don't ever say that concept. But it's hard to teach. I mean, think about teaching a manager how not to be empathetic.
Yeah.
Right? It's almost like a lose-lose situation, because if you're not empathetic, you don't bond with that employee.
Aren't we trying to do just the opposite?
Exactly. And so it was a tough thing. So what I learned was simply to be professional, and really, that's one of the reasons for human resources is to take these things, especially when I wasn't involved in any way, shape, or form. I was not with the company when that happened. I didn't know any of the people in the environment. And so for me to even nod my head and say, well, I can't believe that happened, and those are the kinds of things I was saying, was a mistake on my part. So I had to learn that a very hard way. And there's many instances like that you make mistakes on, because, you know, on a hiring, if you talk about hiring, if you said to an employee something like, well, we look forward to a long and elaborate career, and maybe in 2015 we're going to, What you might have just done is do an employee contract there. Mm. Now, unwillingly and unknowingly, but in that person's mind, they could be saying, oh, 2015, I'm going to start preparing. I've got a project. I've got work till then. And 6 months later, you have to let this person go. And all of a sudden, they bring that back to the table and said, well, we were already talking about 2015, or we were talking about this and that. And so it's those kind of subtle things that human resources really tries to tell management, that you have to be careful. It's at will. It's, you know, talk about today, talk about tomorrow, maybe next week, but you're not talking about further terms, simply because it can be misconstrued. So those are some of the legal issues that can come up. And the pendulum has swung, because obviously it wasn't that strict. And there's a lot of issues there. You know, sometimes it's the labor union, all kinds of things that get involved there. But that's the climate we're in right now. And so you have to be careful on the answers that you say and how you say things and all of that, within reason.
Well, I'm sure that you've piqued the interest of my students with those comments, for sure. So I want to spend a little time talking about communicating ethically, Al. So, you know, issues of confidentiality, issues of copyright, employment issues, employment hiring issues, academic integrity, certainly something we're interested in, merit-based pay. So can you talk to us a little bit about communicating ethically? What does that really mean, and what are we supposed to be thinking about?
That's another tough topic, because what's happened in the marketplace in the last few years is situational ethics. And all I mean by that is, depending on the situation, is how your ethics go. And
yes,
I don't believe in that, and most people I know don't believe in that, but it's becoming more and more prevalent. In other words, if my employer is a jerk, then it's okay to steal.
Mm-hmm.
If they are in the papers because they did some embezzlement, then it's okay for me. You know, it's those kinds of things that happen. I was at Venado Middle School in Irvine just a few months ago, and we actually are talking to sixth graders and seventh graders and eighth graders about this specific topic. And it was a forum where a bunch of us business people got to speak to these kids and sit at a table and talk, and we would ask them questions like, is it okay to download music?
Mm-hmm.
You know, illegal music, somebody else's music, or from a website that you're not buying? Is it okay to copy somebody else's homework? And one of the things on this project we were on, we were never to tell them it was wrong or right. It was something that they would have to discuss to really absorbed by themselves. So it was great discussion, and for the most part we got some good solid answers, but it's something to really think about really from a younger age to ask those kind of questions and discuss that and have fun with it like we tried to do, but yet make it known that it was serious. And so we gave out handouts and had really good discussions. I'll tell you about one of my friends, and this is where ethical and legal will fight a little bit. You know, what's legal isn't necessarily ethical, what's ethical isn't necessarily legal sometimes. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I'll give you an example. One of my friends, Kent, called me, and he had worked for me before, and he was a great employee, great person. And he said, Al, I just accepted a position to go to San Francisco. This was in Boston. And I accepted the position. And when I went to give my notice, they countered. I'm stuck, Al. What do I do? Because I would prefer to stay in Boston rather than relocate my whole family to San Francisco. And I said to Kent, I said, Kent, do you really want to hear my answer? Because you might not want to hear this answer. And he says, no, go ahead and tell me, Al. And I said, Kent, once you give your word to somebody that says, I will relocate, and they stop the hiring process, and they stop looking for other people, and they do all these things there, then you're bound, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. Now, legally, you can obviously do what you need to do. Legally, you could have turned that down. And so with begrudgingly, he heard my answer. And so he actually left. He went to San Francisco, relocated his whole family. But what was the outcome of it was in a couple years, the company countered again, and he left and went back to Boston, took a title of president at the organization, as well as made more money. And so it worked out well for him, because I've had many people come to me. I've hired hundreds of people through the years, interviewed thousands, and I've had people accept the position. I've stopped all the hiring, and then 2 days before they're supposed to show up, or the morning of, they call and say, you know what, I decided against this position. Mm-hmm. Now, legally, they are obviously within their rights to do this.
Yeah.
Ethically, I will never, ever hire them again. And right. If they ever ask me for a reference, or not that they would, or if any of my colleagues ever spoke to me, I would not refer that person. Mm-hmm. So it's a catch-22 there, and I understand there's some issues there because they had, my one friend had to relocate the family. But if you do give your word, one of the biggest things in the business community is your word, in my opinion. And one of the ways things go south is because we break our word. And in communication, that's a big deal. So anyways, that's one of my thoughts, that where it's ethical and legal, that you can cross the line, and that's food for thought at the very least.
That's a great story, Al. Thanks for sharing that with us. Your story made me think about the latest little thing with Instagram. Instagram has decided that they're going to be able to sell your pictures. Well, when you think about the sort of pictures that we take on Instagram, of our cat and a flower in the garden and a nice tree or something like that, you're not, in all likelihood, you're not going to see a picture taken from an iPhone on some giant billboard in New York. So it's not like, chances are that they're not going to sell your little picture for a lot of money. But yet, people were very much in arms about that. Whoa, profiting off of my pictures. And yet, those same people, happy to download music. Happy to download music. So yeah, we kind of have to think about the implications of what we're doing and ethically. Absolutely. So I'm glad that you raised that point.
Right. Very good.
So any examples of questionable business tactics that you've run across? Anything that you can help our students to understand about communicating ethically? Probably you have a lot of them.
Well, I'll give you one that I thought of. I was consulting for an organization. There was four owners, and we were sitting in a room, and we had hired a new salesperson from another organization, actually a competitor. And we went through the half hour of meeting and all of that, and all of a sudden, they asked him a couple questions, and he reached down and he picked up a hard drive, and he says, I have the database for all that particular competitor's information. And everybody hooted and hollered, and they got excited about it, and I can understand why, because that is worth a lot of money, and it's It's got a lot of names and numbers and all kinds of things on there.
Business espionage.
Exactly. And so I sat quiet. I'm a consultant, not the owner, and there was four owners in the room, and so I didn't say a word. And at the end of the meeting, another half hour, 45 minutes, everybody left except the CEO whose office we were in, and I went to him and I said, Jim, now it's your company, and I understand why we're hooting and hollering about getting their database, but I'm not comfortable with it.
Good for you.
And if it was your, if I were sitting in another office and they brought your database, I would be doing the same thing. And so mm-hmm. I'm not comfortable with it. You're the boss. You can do what you will, but I'm not comfortable with it. And so he, you know, we excused each other and I went off and took him a couple of days. And he finally sent me an email. He says, you're right, Al. I'm not going to use this. And so they did the right thing, which was obviously very ethical and communicated well. And it was a good thing. And from a integrity perspective and all of that, we could rest easier and do better business, in my opinion. So that's one example out there.
Gosh, that's, you're a light to the world, Al. That's wonderful. I'm so happy to finally get a story like this. So happy to, you know, talk to somebody that I know, you know, face to face, that has a story like that, because I think that we need leaders that will be strong enough to do that. I mean, from your perspective as a consultant, you're like, oh, well, maybe I'll get fired, maybe I'll lose the gig, they won't want me anymore, and yet you risked all of that in order to be a strong ethical presence for them, and probably help them in the end.
Right. And I think it's the opposite, by the way. A lot of people, they have this thing called job security, where they don't pass information out because they feel like it's job security for them. Mm-hmm. Whenever I find that out in an environment where I am the boss or I have the power, that's the person to go, in my opinion, because it's the opposite. A good manager, a good employee should be passing out information to help the organization grow, to help the organization move forward. And I've met so many people that they will control all of that simply because they think it's job security, or they think that it's the right thing to do for their career. And it's really the opposite. And it's something to think through and think about. So I've always, you know, when somebody leaves, they go on vacation for 3 days or they get sick for 3 days and the organization starts to crumble, whatever department, whether it's a two-person department or a 50-person department starts to crumble, there's an issue there with that manager. And that manager then put in place communication things and processes and infrastructure there so that some issue happened, they could take care of it, right? Mm-hmm. So it's an opposite. For me, at least, when people withhold information is when I look down on that. And it's food for thought. It makes perfect sense, in my opinion.
Gosh, I love that. Thank you. Thank you for sharing that. Before you came in, we talked about the grapevine.
Uh-huh.
And just kind of want to get some thoughts from you about the grapevine, how it works and what you notice about it, what
Sure.
you think about it.
Okay. So I'll give the definition. A grapevine, the formal communication channel, and then the grapevine is the informal communication channel. And that's just a real easy, there's more definition to that, but it's a real easy way to look at this.
Sure.
When I go to a company and I'm consulting, I get in front of the senior people on who I'm working on the project. So the senior people will tell me what is happening, what is going on, what they think, and what the problems are, and so forth and so on. I don't think I've ever seen it to be the actual problem and issue and challenge when I go to the floor, so to speak. It's different. What the CEO says in a business meeting, what the vice president says in communication, is generally different at the line level. And so what I've learned in the past, and I still do it, is I go to the line, to the people who are actually doing the work. Now, I have to go listen to the management speak, so to speak, and understand that. And then I go directly to the people dealing with the customers, doing the products, creating the services, programming the computer, whatever it is at the level of actual work, so to speak. And what I find, I would say 98% of the time, is it's different. What the VP or president, CEO thinks is happening is not happening. And one of the reasons are is because we have guarded communication.
We protect, right, exactly.
And I've sat in meetings where I say, you know, this should be shared, and people will give me the need to know, and all of these kinds of things, which cripple the ability for people to do work, you know. So I like the big picture thing. In fact, on Wednesday, I'm having a meeting with two groups where we're telling them exactly, how did you do in 2012? And as a consultant, I'm encouraging the managers, and I'm putting a template for them. Exactly how did we do in 2012? Exactly. Here's the numbers. Here's what we think those numbers mean. Here's what we would like for you to try and decipher and help us with. And then here's 2013. Here's the goals and objectives, by the way, which you helped create. And let's have a fruitful discussion on how we get there and what we need to do with you in the room. And that's the difference. I've been to so many organizations where that's handed down. Now, how can you really expect somebody who hasn't bought into it, isn't part of the planning process, hasn't told you the why issues are happening and so forth and so on. But anyways, going back to that informal, if you would sit with the people actually doing the work, the informal network instead of the managerial goals, those are all important. The vision, mission, values, all of those are important, but it needs to be taken into consideration with the informal network, the informal chatter, and all the people who are saying, wow, we barely made this, and if we could have this, if we could have that, it would be improved. And so much of that is missing in normal corporate communications. You know, one of the things I didn't put on my bio is 20 months ago, I started a company called Speak Up, Speak Out, and communicating at level 10. And it's simply because no matter where I went, there were two issues in the company. One was money in the last 4 or 5 years, as we know.
Sure.
And the second one was communication. In fact, I heard Geri talk about that. Communication is always at the top one, two, maybe three, but it's always at the top there somewhere. And through all the things that we know, we wonder why. Why is that? We know that communication is an issue, so we should communicate at that level, you know? And there's lots of issues there, lots of reasons. I'll tell you one quick thing. I worked at LAWA, Los Angeles World Airports. And the one thing there that was so prominent is there's 113 languages spoken there.
Oh, my goodness.
English is one. Now think about that environment for just a second.
Yeah.
113 primary languages spoken. English is one of those languages.
Mm-hmm.
So what could happen in communication? What is really the behind the scenes communication that is happening? And so it was very challenging. I did a project for one of the large sheriff's departments in the nation, one of the largest sheriff's departments in the nation. And before I did the class, I asked, how many are English as their second language? And what I heard floored me. They said 95% in this particular city, large city. And at first I said, that can't be. 95%, I would believe 50, maybe 60. 95%, and then I had my first class of about 20, 22 people, and I saw the breakdown, and absolutely, it was that kind of high number. So you really have to go behind the scenes. You really have to look at informal communications, because that will tell you so much more than what you're hearing. Not that anybody's lying or doing any of that, but the real story lies behind the scenes, in my opinion.
I like the way you frame that up. That's pretty important. So it sounds like in your line of work that you've might have had the opportunity at working at overcoming communication barriers.
Mm-hmm.
Sounds like that's kind of what you've been focused on, both verbal and nonverbal. And so any stories around those communication barriers? I mean, you told us the one about the LAX airport. That's certainly...
Well, I'll follow up on that LAX airport concept. And basically, what was happening is some people were felt like they were being harassed.
Oh.
And other people were saying, we're just being jovial.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And we're just playing. We're just having fun. What's wrong with, you know, saying these kinds of things? And what's wrong with all of that? So I had to do diversity classes. I had to do an environment where what is construed to be something from one person or one group or one environment is misrepresented in another, and it was a challenge. And so those, and so we talk about verbal, vocal, visual, which is obviously body language, as well as virtual now. So those are the four things that happen in communication.
Can
if
you say
think
those
about,
again for us?
Verbal, the words I say. Vocal is how I say things. What are the intonations? How I say something, thank you versus thank you, means totally different things to different people. Then we have visual, body language, and Geri, you might have heard the study, and we may not agree with that study, but there was a study up in UCLA by Dr. Moravian that talked about 7% is what words matter, and I was always floored by that. But 38% is how we say things, and 55% was our body language. Mm. And so whether those words are exact or semi or whatever, it floored me. And I had to really study that because my environment is verbal, you know, and I had to really put down and say, how did I say that? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And is, you know, you might have met a person who walks up to you and shakes your hand and say, pleased to meet you. Mm-hmm. Now, automatically we're thinking, are you really pleased, right? Are you really pleased? And that handshake is very weak and they're eyes are not right. It's those kinds of things. Mm-hmm. And the last one is virtual, because we're now in a virtual world, right? Mm-hmm. So we're Twittering and we're doing all kinds of things on social media. And so that has been a big part, and it will continue to grow, by the way. The growth of social media is incredible. And so one of the issues and challenges on social media, on email, and by the way, email is the most widely used communication device, but it's the least effective. And it's simply because we do not have body language. We do not have intonation. Think about that for a second. Mm-hmm. We do not have intonation. We don't have body language. So what I'm reading on the print, I have to take at face value, which may be exactly or not how you're trying to convey something. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so there's a lot of things to do with that. And you know, one of the sayings I've had for years is communication is not just a skill. It is the skill. Mm-hmm. And really what I mean by that is I've met a lot of brilliant people, 10 times smarter than myself, but they can't convey their ideas out. They can't communicate that out. We can't have a good discussion. They're talking way past me. And then I've had average IQ people like myself who can communicate, who can convince, who can persuade, mm-hmm. and we can rise up simply because our communication skills are at a certain level.
Yes, indeed. Those are wise words. I want to talk to you a little bit about email. You brought up email, and I want to talk to you about that. But I don't want to ignore Steve. Thanks for writing in, Steve. So Steve, one of our students asks of you, do you know of any YouTube videos or books that can help define the ROI on training? Do you have any thoughts about that?
I'll get the title, and there's a book that actually defines that and just talks about ROI on training, and it's a couple hundred pages, and I can't think of it at the top of my head.
I know who you're talking about. You're talking about seven steps of ROI. His name is at the top of my head too, but I know what you're talking about.
So I can bring it in. Good.
So I'll make a note to myself to do that ROI reference for Steve. So, it's my honey-do list. So I want to talk a little bit about email, because you brought it up. And I don't know. You know, I think we have a little bit of a blasé attitude about email. We write these emails and send them off, but then God knows where they end up. And so I wanted to brainstorm with my students a little bit about, and perhaps you can text us and let us know as Al explains a little bit. But let's brainstorm. What are some places that your sent email can end up? Text me. What do you think? What are some places that a sent email can end up? I mean, to start us off, and please just go ahead and send us your information, your ideas. So first of all, I mean, they can end up in the sender's inbox, obviously, right? That's obvious. They can end up in your trash bin, right? If you like for me, my email is set up so whenever I send an email out, I CC myself, and then those all just go into the trash bin. I know I've got them for a day or a week or something like that if I need them. So they can be in the server, the receiver's inbox, they can be in your trash bin. They can be in your inbox, a duplicate copy, whatever. They can be in your, that person that you sent it to could forward it on to others, right? And so it can be sitting on a server that's twice removed from your server. And so as we just brainstorm all of the different places that that an email can end up, my reaction is like, yikes!
Right.
What would you say to that, Al?
Oh, I'll tell you. I'll admit something that's kind of funny is, probably 15 years ago, an email was written and it had several of our names in it. It's still out there. Somebody actually got mad at us from our organization, started a website. That email is still out there. It's been about a year since I've checked, but I would Google it every once in a while. So Al Batinga, and here it is. It pops up and it talks about the company, has real negative things to say. There are websites out there that actually keep those things. And so it's one of those things where it's once it's sent, it's out there in the Ethernet somewhere, somehow.
It's out there.
And in fact, I'll give you a quick funny story. I was working with somebody and they had something very nasty to say to me. And so they sent off this email to me and I'm looking at my inbox and it pops in and I open it up and boy, this guy was very angry at me and I was confused, but I read it. And as I read it, a note came in and it says, trying to extract it. In other words, they were trying to do the unsend or the, I forget what button that was, but they were trying to bring it back out. And it's something funny because they couldn't, once I received it, they couldn't get it back. And so anyways, it was an effect on this. And I'll give you a quick story. Abraham Lincoln was reputed to get very angry about things and he would write the letter and then he would stick it in his drawer and he would say something like, in 24 hours, if I still feel the same way, mm-hmm. I will send this letter. And many of the letters were found unsent. And so emails are same kind of thing. When we send things out that we really didn't mean or think through or whatever the case may be, it's out there forever. And it can be, you know, one of the legal things. It can be used in court now. It can be used as evidence. I mean, all kinds of things. And even if it's deleted, there's so many, you know, so it's a very interesting topic. And so email is something that can be used legally, something that will follow you. You could be applying for a job and somebody will see an old email that was rotated around because they Googled your name. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of things there with email that are
that we don't
lasting.
Think about at the time.
Exactly.
And they have implications.
Exactly.
Gosh, yeah. So Steve has written in some other suggestions here. He says, on your boss's laptop, on your competitor's laptop, and CNN, and then he makes a joke, your ex-wife's laptop as well, too. Mm-hmm. So you're exactly right, Steve. Thanks for that humorous response. It's something that we all have to kind of wake up to the knowledge, and I kind of do that too. You know, you mentioned that wonderful tactic that Abraham Lincoln had of not sending out mail. I kind of do that a little bit too. If I have a more complex email, I'll start it, I'll write it, I'll save it, I'll go away and come back to it, and then, you know, doggone it, when I come back, I find like a little typo that I wouldn't have noticed if I had sent it the first time.
Right.
All those things add up. Oh, right. My gosh. Mm-hmm. So I'm just looking at the list to see if there's any other areas that we might have. I think we've pretty much got them all, except the other place that you could find an email that is lost is on social networking sites, mm-hmm. too, right? That's the
exactly.
one thing that none of us identified.
Right. Yeah. They're finding tweets that somebody sent six months ago.
Yeah, that's right.
So, yes.
So people's reputation can be damaged. And we see that on Facebook all the time.
Right.
Oh, look what so-and-so tweeted.
Exactly.
In a moment of passion, in a moment of heat, in a moment of anger.
Right.
Oh, my gosh. So do you think that this whole social media thing is like helping us to be more moderated human beings? Is it helping us to be more thoughtful human beings? What do you think?
I don't think so.
I personally
don't think so. And my kids are 18 and 20. And I remember getting on the phone and going somewhere. And I said to my daughter, do you mind calling them? And she said something like, can't I text them? You know, it's a different generation.
Yeah.
And what's happening is people are losing the communication skills, because if a lot of their communications via email and social media, just think about how many actual communication, verbal, vocal, visual, that they actually miss. And so it's happening as we speak. People are coming out of high school and sometimes even not a college, and they don't have that interpersonal communication, which when it all comes down to it, it goes back to it. Because when you interview with me, it's not gonna be off your tweets, it's not gonna be off of any of that. It's gonna be me and you face to face, sitting here. I'm gonna be looking at your body language, I'm gonna be looking at how you answer things, your eye contact, all of those things, which has to be, because of the economy, has to be up. Right? We have, instead of having 20 people to choose from, we have 200. That's just a fact, right? Yeah. Unfortunately, but true. And so you're competing with other people, and communication skills is at the top of the roll, as far as I'm concerned, and many, many other people feel the same way. So social media has a place. It's not something I would throw away. There's a lot of good communication. In fact, at the organization I'm with right now, consulting for, I've recommended that we do messaging between computers because we call and we can't reach people. So it definitely has a place, but it has to be in its place. And it's something to think about. And our skills cannot be lost because we're so tied into social media.
Gosh. Yeah, and just we're almost out of time, and it's been so much fun talking to you.
I've
really appreciated it. But just want to make a last point about texting, about how I now actually prefer to text rather than send a voicemail. So there you have it. Even Professor G can learn. See you all next week. Guest lecture. I'll see you the week after next, everyone. Bye now.